Applying these principles brings about three results. The first is that stalkers learn never to take themselves seriously, they learn to laugh at themselves. If they're not afraid of being a fool, they can fool anyone. The second is that stalkers learn to have endless patience. Stalkers are never in a hurry, they never fret. And the third is that stalkers learn to have an endless capacity to improvise. Florinda stood up. We had been sitting, as usual, in her living room. I immediately assumed that our conversation was over. She said that there was one more topic to present to me before we said goodbye. She took me to another patio inside her house. I had never been in that part of her house before. She called someone softly and a woman stepped out from the room. I did not recognize her at first. The woman called my name and then I realized that she was Donna Soledad. Her change was stupendous. She was younger and more powerful. Florinda said that Soledad had been inside a recapitulating crate for 5 years, that the eagle had accepted her recapitulation in place of her awareness and had let her go free. Donna Soledad assented with a movement of her head. Florinda abruptly ended the meeting and told me that it was time for me to leave because I had no more energy. I went to Florinda's house many more times afterward. I saw her every time but only for a few moments. She told me that she had decided not to instruct me anymore because it was to my advantage that I deal only with Donna Soledad. Donna Soledad and I met several times, but whatever took place during our meetings is something quite incomprehensible to me. Every time we were together, she would make me sit at the door of her room facing the east. She would sit to my right, touching me, then we would make the wall of fog stop rotating and both of us would be left facing the south, into her room. I had already learned with La Gorda to stop the rotation of the wall. It seemed that Donna Soledad was helping me to realize another aspect of that perceptual capacity. I had correctly detected with La Gorda that only a portion of us stopped the wall. It was as if suddenly I had become divided in two. A portion of my total self was looking straight ahead and saw an immobile wall to my right, while another larger portion of my total self had turned 90 degrees to the right and was staring at the wall. Every time Donna Soledad and I stopped the wall, we remained staring at it. We never entered into the area between the parallel lines as the Nagual woman, La Gorda and I had done scores of times. Donna Soledad would make me gaze every time into the fog as if the fog were a reflective glass. I would experience then the most extravagant disassociation. It was as if I were racing at breakneck speed. I would see bits of a landscape forming in the fog, and suddenly I was in another physical reality. It was a mountainous area, rugged and inhospitable. Donna Soledad was always there in the company of a lovely woman who laughed uproariously at me. My incapacity to remember what we did beyond that point was even more acute than my incapacity to remember what the Nagual woman and La Gorda and I did in the area between the parallel lines. It seemed that Donna Soledad and I entered into another area of awareness that was unknown to me. I was already in what I thought was my keenest state of consciousness, and yet there was something even keener. The aspect of the second attention that Donna Soledad was obviously showing me was more complex and more inaccessible than anything I had witnessed so far. All I could recollect was a sense of having moved a great deal, a physical sensation comparable to having walked for miles, or to having hiked on rugged mountain trails. I also had a clear bodily certainty, although I could not fathom why, that Donna Soledad, the woman, and I exchanged words, thoughts, feelings, but I could not pinpoint them. After every meeting with Donna Soledad, Florinda would immediately make me leave. Donna Soledad gave minimal verbal feedback. It appeared to me that being in a state of such heightened awareness affected her so profoundly she could hardly talk. There was something that we were seeing in that rugged landscape besides the lovely woman, or something we were doing together that left us breathless. She could not remember anything, although she tried. I asked Florinda to clarify the nature of my journeys with Donna Soledad. She said that a part of her last-minute instruction was to make me enter into the second attention as stalkers do, and that Donna Soledad was more capable than she herself was to usher me into the stalker's dimension. On the meeting that was to be our last, Florinda, as she had done at the beginning of our instruction, was waiting for me in the hall. She took my arm and led me to the living room. We sat down. She warned me not to try as yet to make sense of my journeys with Donna Soledad. She explained that stalkers are inherently different than dreamers in the way they use the world around them, and that what Donna Soledad was doing was trying to help me to turn my head. When Don Juan had described the concept of turning a warrior's head to face a new direction, I had understood it as a metaphor that depicted a change in attitude. Florinda said that that description was true, but it was no metaphor. It was true that stalkers turn their heads, however, they do not turn them to face a new direction, but to face time in a different way. Stalkers face the oncoming time. Normally we face time as it recedes from us. Only stalkers can change that and face time as it advances on them. Florinda explained that turning the head did not mean that one sees into the future, but that one sees time as something concrete, yet incomprehensible. It was superfluous, therefore, for me to try to think out whatever Donna Soledad and I were doing. All of it would make sense when I could perceive the totality of myself and would then have the energy necessary to unravel that mystery. Florinda told me, in the spirit of someone giving a bonus, that Donna Soledad was a supreme stalker. She called her the greatest of them all. She said that Donna Soledad could cross the parallel lines anytime. Furthermore, none of the warriors of Don Juan Matis' party had been able to do what she had done. Donna Soledad, through her impeccable stalking techniques, had found her parallel being. Florinda explained that whatever I had experienced with the Negril Juan Matis, or Silvio Manuel, or Jenna Uro, or Zuliaka were only minute portions of the second attention. Whatever Donna Soledad was helping me witness was still another minute, but different portion. Donna Soledad had not only made me face the oncoming time, but she had taken me to her parallel being. Florinda defined the parallel being as the counterbalance that all living creatures have by the fact that they are luminous beings filled with inexplicable energy. A parallel being of any person is another person of the same sex who is intimately and inextricably joined to the first one. They coexist in the world at the same time. The two parallel beings are like the two ends of the same pole. It is nearly impossible for warriors to find their parallel being, because there are too many distracting factors in the life of a warrior, other priorities. But whoever is capable of accomplishing this feat would find, in his parallel being, just as Donna Soledad had, an endless source of youth and energy. Florinda stood up abruptly and took me to Donna Soledad's room. Perhaps because I knew that it was going to be our last meeting, I was taken by a strange anxiety. Donna Soledad smiled at me when I told her what Florinda had just told me. She said, with what I thought to be a true warrior's humbleness, that she was not teaching me anything, that all she had aspired to do was to show me her parallel being, because that would be where she would retreat when the Negril Juan Matis and his warriors left the world. However, something else had happened which was beyond her understanding. Florinda had explained to her that we had boosted each other's energy and that had made us face the oncoming time, not in small doses as Florinda would have liked us to, but in incomprehensible gobbles as my unruly nature wanted it. The result of our last meeting was even more baffling. Donna Soledad, her parallel being and I remained for what I felt was an extraordinarily long time together. I saw every feature of the parallel being's face. I felt she was trying to tell me who she was. She also seemed to be cognizant that this was our last meeting. There was such an overpowering sense of frailty in her eyes. Then a wind-like force blew us away into something that held no meaning for me. Florinda suddenly helped me to stand up. She took me by the arm and led me to the door. Donna Soledad walked with us. Florinda said that I would have a hard time remembering all that had transpired because I was indulging in my rationality, a condition that could only worsen because they were about to leave and I would have no one to help me to shift levels of awareness. She added that someday Donna Soledad and I would meet again in the world of everyday life. It was then that I turned to Donna Soledad and begged her to drive me out of my indulging. I told her that if she failed she should kill me. I did not want to live in the meagerness of my rationality. It's wrong to say that, Florinda said. We are warriors, and warriors have only one thing in mind, their freedom. To die and be eaten by the eagle is no challenge. On the other hand, to sneak around the eagle and be free is the ultimate audacity.